All right, well, this evening we're returning to Luke 14. Let me go ahead and read the text again, the verses we looked at this morning and the ones we're going to be looking at this evening. There is a lot in these verses, so we're only going to be able to touch on just the main ideas. But again, very sobering things that our Lord calls us to pay attention to. And not the least of which is his closing words about the salt, losing its saltiness and being thrown out and being worthless. Those are very sobering words. If we love the Lord, certainly they don't apply to us, but if we don't, they could. So that's what we need to think about this evening. So let me read the text to begin with. Beginning in verse 25. Luke writes, "Now large crowds were going along with him. And he turned and said to them, 'If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which one of you, when he wants to build a tower, does not first sit down and calculate the cost? To see if he has enough to complete it. Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who observe it begin to ridicule him, saying, "This man began to build and was not able to finish." Or what king, when he sets out to meet another king in battle, will not first sit down and consider whether he is strong enough with 10,000 men to encounter the one coming against him with 20,000, or else while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So then, none of you can be my disciple who does not give up all his own possessions. Therefore, salt is good, but if even salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? It is useless either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." May the Lord bless his word to our understanding this evening. Now again, this morning, remember, we saw that as the crowds were following our Lord Jesus, he turned to them with a challenge that was calculated to sift the wheat from the chaff, the believers from the unbelievers. He told them what must be true of them if they would be his disciples, if they would be, in other words, Christians, because remember, disciples and Christians are essentially the same thing. Now, we also noted that the same things that Jesus told them must also be true of us if we are his disciples, if we are believers, if we are the brothers and sisters of our Lord Jesus Christ, and those things are that we love him far more than our families, far more than our comforts, far more even than our lives, so that we're willing to give those things up, any of those things, if our Lord should call us to do so. But we also saw this, and again, this is where the gospel comes in, because without this, we'd have nothing really but law, that what the Lord requires, he gives to us through the gospel. I mean, Jesus knows that we can't do these things. He knows that no one is able to do these things as we come into the world. That's why he came into the world, that he might give us this kind of love. So what Jesus is really doing here is he's challenging us through this text, as he was challenging also those who were in the crowd, to take a step back and to look at our lives to see if this love is actually there. If it isn't, Jesus is telling us we need to come to him because he's the only one who can give us this love. But if it is there, we need to be comforted in the fact that we know Jesus. But also we need, I think, as we compare our lives to what Jesus is calling us here, we need to strengthen that love by drawing near to him. Now, I think we already noticed this morning, and we noticed again this evening, that this wasn't the end of what Jesus had to say. Jesus continued to probe the crowd after telling them what must be true of them before they should come to him and become his disciples. He asked them, told them, they needed to count the cost. whether or not they are willing to pay what it's going to cost to follow him. And this evening, Jesus asks us the same. Now again, here's where the difficulty arises a bit, because Jesus is really addressing a crowd that hasn't come to him, and we are those who have come to him. So as we look at these things, let's again consider what it is that Jesus calls us to do, what we've already looked at, what we've already committed ourselves to do, and recommit ourselves to doing these things. So the question is, what is that cost? Well, if we would be his disciples, Jesus says we must, first of all, be intent on finishing what we start. Secondly, on fighting until we win. And thirdly, on giving all that we have to him. So first of all, he says we must be intent on finishing what we have started. Now, he asks the question in verses 28 and 30. For which one of you, when he wants to build a tower, does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who observe it begin to ridicule him, saying, "This man began to build and was not able to finish." Now again, the illustration of a tower may seem a bit foreign to us, because I don't know that any of us here built a tower. But what would our neighbors think of us if we basically set out to build a house, right? And we laid the foundation, but then we gave up, right? Or perhaps we laid the foundation and we nailed together a couple of 2x4s, but then abandoned the project. I think they would wonder whether we were really serious about wanting to build the house in the first place. Well, the same thing is true when it comes to living the Christian life. If we set out to follow the Lord Jesus, to do what it is he calls us to do, but we only go a short way and then we give up, the question is going to be asked by those who observe us, did we really ever want to finish? Was it really ever in our hearts to do so? Jesus is telling us that we need to count the cost, because if we're going to start, we need to finish. And if we aren't going to finish, if that's not our intent, it would be better then never to start. So Jesus says, before we start, we need to count the cost, as we've been considering, whether we have what it takes to make it to the end, to build, as it were, this tower, or to complete the Christian race. Now, we know that Jesus tells us up front, this is something that that we need to be thankful for. When Satan, of course, tries to enlist people into his army, he always hides the cost that's involved, doesn't he? Thomas Brooks reminds us that the devil is a master fisherman who knows what bait to use in order to basically entice us, that which is most likely to make us fall. But he also reminds us that Satan hides the hook. He hides the real cost of what it means to follow him. He hides the judgment. He hides, you know, the destination, which is essentially hell, because he knows that if he were to show us that up front, that no one would ever want to follow him. But that's something that Jesus does not do. Jesus shows us the cost up front. And he asks us the question in advance, if this is the cost, are you willing to pay it? And so that's a question we do need to ask. Are we willing to pay? Now, what is it that he's actually asking us to do? You know, is the cost what many well-meaning Christians teach in churches today, just a willingness to come forward and to pray the sinner's prayer? I mean, there are people who believe that that's the extent of the Christian life, is coming forward and praying a prayer. They don't even see it sometimes as the inception of the Christian life, but as the totality of the Christian life. The college that we went to, that's what they believe. That's all that was necessary. And if you did nothing other than that, then you were saved. That's the cost. Pray the prayer and you're in. Is the cost praying the prayer and then maybe coming to church every once in a while when we feel like it? Is it throwing a few dollars into the offering now and then? And other than that, basically doing what we want to do, when we want to do it, for the rest of our lives? Again, that's how many view the Christian life, because they think of it in terms of it's grace. Jesus does it all. Here, accept Jesus, get the ticket, get on the gospel train, take the ride to heaven, and on the way, pretty much live the way you want to live. Well, I think we understand that the cost that Jesus is asking us to count is actually much higher than that. It is the willingness to deny ourselves, our families, our friends, and our comforts. It is the willingness to give up all of our sins, even those that we love the most, those that we have a hard time really admitting that are sins, because we really don't want to believe it, because we don't want to give it up. And it means doing what the Lord has called us to do in His Word, regardless of what it might cost us, our reputation, our possessions, our freedom, or even our lives. Are we willing to follow Jesus at this cost? Are we willing to finish what we start? Okay, so that's the first question that Jesus is addressing when he says we need to count the cost to see if we have enough to complete it, right? Enough to complete it. Now, again, if we are true believers, we do, okay? And Jesus will make sure that we do. But let's move on to the next question. Second, will we fight until we win? Jesus continues in verses 31 and 32. Or what king, when he sets out to meet another king in battle, will not first sit down and consider whether he is strong enough with 10,000 men to encounter the one coming against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. Now, everyone would be familiar with this illustration in his day, and they would know, and as we would as well, I'm sure, in our own day, if we're going to go to war with another country, we do need to sit down first and consider whether or not we have any chance of winning that particular war with what we have at our disposal before we would enter into that war. And if we come to the conclusion that we don't, that we would then seek to make peace with the enemy. Well, Jesus wants us to consider the same thing when it comes to following him. Do we have what we need to enlist in his army? Do we have what we need to fight our enemies? And are we willing to fight against those enemies until we win? Do we have a chance of winning? Okay. Will we fight against our enemies? Now, our enemies are the flesh. Are we willing to fight against it? The moral corruption in our souls, that which is constantly drawing us away from the Lord, when, as we've seen, to be strong, we need to draw near to the Lord, and drawing us into the sin that will weaken us and basically make us ineffective. Well, Jesus says if we're going to follow him, that is what we must be willing to do. Remember what Paul writes in Romans 8, verse 13. If you are living according to the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. We have to be, as believers, fighting against our sins, fighting against our corruption, seeking to put the remnants of the old man to death. That's a part of our spiritual warfare. We must also be willing to fight against the world, against our love for the things that are against God's will. This is what we must do if we would follow Jesus. John writes this in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world, nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. We have to fight against that desire for the things of the world. Not, of course, the beauty the Lord has placed here, not the good gifts that he gives to us in his providence. That's not what he's talking about, but it's the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the boastful pride of life. Those are the things we must be willing to fight against to the point where we don't love them, but hate them. And then the question comes, will we resist the devil? The devil is at work. He may not be dealing with us personally. We may not be important enough for him to do that. He can't be everywhere at once. But he has a large host of demons who who are working along with him, and perhaps they are involved with us, working with our flesh, working through the world in order to try to get us to fall into sin. Are we willing to resist and to fight against the devil? That's what Jesus says we must do if we are to follow him. 1 Peter 5, verses 8 and 9. Be of sober spirit. Be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. Jesus says, you know, are you willing to fight against these enemies and fight to the end? Or are we going to make peace with our enemies? Have we made peace with them? And then finally, the question comes, will we give everything we have to Jesus? Luke 14, verse 33. Jesus says, so then, none of you can be my disciple who does not give up all his own possessions. If we are to follow him, we need to recognize that not only our lives, not only our souls, not only our bodies, but everything we have belongs to him and is at his disposal. Remember the parables of the hidden treasure and the pearl of great price. What is it that Jesus was teaching through these things? It is that we must be willing to give up everything in order to have him. Jesus tells us in Matthew 13, verses 44 through 46, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and hid again, and from joy over it he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking fine pearls. And upon finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. You see the idea of the kingdom of heaven being so precious, Jesus being so precious, that we're willing to part with everything that we have in order to possess it. No one can be my disciple, Jesus says, unless he gives up all his own possessions, everything that he has. And that includes not just his material possessions, but his gifts, his resources, his time, his talents, his body, his soul, everything to Jesus. Now, when it comes to material possessions, let's not forget that Jesus is not necessarily telling us here that if we're going to follow him, that we have to liquidate all of our assets and give it away, as he told the rich young ruler. He told him that because that was his God, because that was keeping him from following Jesus. But Jesus does mean that if we're to follow him, we have to see ourselves as his stewards from that point on, to use what he has given us for his purposes. I mean, think about Moses. Moses, because he was raised by Pharaoh's daughter, had a privileged position in Egypt, the wealthiest nation on earth, I believe, at that time. And Moses gave it all up. He gave up the honor, he gave up the wealth, and turned his gifts and his energies to leading God's people out of slavery and into the promised land when the Lord called him to do this. We read in Hebrews 11, verses 24 through 26. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to endure ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, considering the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. Remember what Jesus told his disciples in at least Matthew's gospel, I think in probably the Synoptic Gospels, when he says it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into heaven. Do you realize that Moses was a rich man, and yet he gave it all up in order to enter into heaven because of the Lord's mercy on him? Now that is the price Jesus tells us that we must be willing to pay. And the question is, are we willing to pay it? Are we willing to see the race through to the end? Are we willing basically to build this tower, to build this house that we need to build? Are we willing to go out against an army that is certainly much fiercer than we are? You know, I mean, we're talking about one against spiritual enemies, any one of which would destroy us, but of course with the Lord on our side. And are we willing to give all that we have in order to follow Jesus? Jesus tells us to count the cost. Now, if we really don't love the Lord, as many in the crowd did not love the Lord, then we will not be willing to pay this price. Now, if that's the case, Jesus does have a warning, you know, at the end, and I think this is one of the most sobering warnings that's repeated throughout Scripture, and it's contained in verses 34 and 35. So let's read that again. He says, "Therefore, salt is good, but if even salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? It is useless either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Now, essentially, the salt that becomes, you know, tasteless, it's referring to a person who's professing faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, but who loses saltiness. It's not talking about a true believer who basically falls away from the Lord and perishes, because Jesus here is talking about the salt being cast out. It is now useless, and it's being trampled, essentially, in another place, I think it's in Matthew chapter 5, it's being trampled underfoot by men. Here he says it's useless for the soil or the manure pile. It's essentially thrown out. He's not talking about a true believer losing his salvation, but what he's talking about here is somebody who is professing faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, who professes to be salt and light, as the Lord calls us to, but is not really salt and light. This is a warning against what we call apostasy. Apostasy is not a true believer falling away. Apostasy is somebody making a profession who isn't genuine, who eventually falls away. This is a warning against beginning the Christian life, beginning to build the tower, as it were, or the house, but not finishing it. Or taking up the warfare, but then making peace with our enemies. Against seeming to come to Jesus, but then not being willing to give all that we have to him. It's essentially the same thing that the author to the Hebrews warns us about in chapter 6, verses 4 through 8. And that passage right there is probably the passage that, well, if you haven't read that as at some point in your lives as a believer and shuddered at it, then the full impact of it perhaps hasn't hit you. And maybe you've wondered for some time what it actually means. But it's a warning against the same thing, against apostasy. This is what the author to the Hebrews writes. "For in the case of those who have once been enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and have been made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come and then have fallen away, it is impossible to renew them again to repentance, since they again crucify to themselves the Son of God and put him to open shame. For ground that drinks the rain which often falls on it and brings vegetation, useful to those for whose sake it is also tilled, receives a blessing from God. But if it yields thorns and thistles, it is worthless and close to being cursed and ends up being burned." Now, I should have read perhaps the next verse, because the next verse actually tells us that the author of the Hebrews here is not talking about true believers, because he goes on to say, "But brethren, we are convinced of better things concerning you, and things that accompany salvation, though I am speaking in this way." So what he is saying here, he's talking about things that can be true of people who really don't know the Lord, but appear as though they do know the Lord, who then, after all these privileges, all this basically truth that they're given, and the work of the Holy Spirit in a more general and common way, convicting them and so forth of their sins, having all these privileges and then falling away, that there's really nothing more that can be done for them. He was talking to, of course, the Jews that were in danger of turning away from Christianity because of the persecution of Rome against the Christians. The Jews were not being persecuted. But as Rome began to realize that Christians were being persecuted by the Jews, and that the Christians were not a part of the Jews, and that only the Jewish religion had permission to exist without basically persecution, they began to persecute the Christians, and the Jewish Christians were being tempted then to go back to Judaism. Well, these Jews, like the ones Jesus was speaking with in the crowd, were enlightened. They had God's truth. The scriptures were being read every Sabbath in the synagogue. They had rabbis to teach them. They had seen the fulfillment of these things in the Lord Jesus Christ. They had been made partakers of the Spirit's ministry, not his saving ministry, but at least his more common general ministry of convicting and convincing them of their sins, giving them a clearer viewer of themselves and their need for Jesus. And yet, with all these privileges and blessings, they still didn't believe. They claimed to for a while. They were in the church, you know, the church that the author to the Hebrews is addressing, but they eventually fell away, and some of them without remedy. You know, some of them fell away entirely, and there was no longer any hope for them. Jesus is giving us a warning here, and he says that there does come a point when the Lord has given enough, when he's done enough to convince, when he's given them enough privileges, when he finally abandons someone and leaves them in their sins. Now, that isn't true of anyone who still has any concern for their souls. Obviously, as when Jesus pronounced basically accused the Jewish leaders, some of the Pharisees on one occasion, of having committed the unpardonable sin, it was because they knew who Jesus was. They knew he had cast out the demon by the Holy Spirit, but yet they still accused him of doing it by Satan. They hated Jesus, and their hearts were sealed against him. So the Lord is not talking about people who want still to come into the kingdom. He's talking about people who have so hardened their hearts against him that he abandons them forever in their sins, the point of no return. This is really what Jesus is warning them of in this text. And obviously what he would warn any of us here tonight, if we have not found it in our hearts to accept his terms of discipleship. I mean, there is a point of no return. The only ones who are in danger of actually reaching that point are those who haven't come to Christ. If you haven't trusted in Jesus, you need to trust him. That's the only way you're going to be safe. But on the other hand, remember, Jesus wants us to know that if we have found this love within our hearts and this desire to take up the mantle of discipleship, even if that love is very imperfect, and it is in each one of us, if we are willing to put him first, before our comforts, before our families, before our lives, if we have picked up our crosses, basically setting our own goals aside to follow him, and have been willing to bear up under his difficulties, if we are willing to finish what we start, to fight until we win and enter that kingdom, give everything that we have to him, then Jesus wants us to know that we are his disciples. We are true believers. Jesus said to his disciples in the Sermon on the Mount, "You are the salt of the earth." If these things are true of us, that is what we are. We are that preserving influence that the Lord Jesus has put into the world to restrain evil. And so our Lord wants us to be the salt by following his example and by sharing his message. But again, in order to do that, remember, we're only going to find the strength to be able to do that if we draw near to him. We have to fellowship with the Lord. We have to spend time with the Lord. We have to be fighting against our spiritual enemies, and we won't be able to do that unless we have the strength the Lord calls us to do. We need to run the race, but we can't do that without his strength. He says he will provide it, but it doesn't happen automatically. We need to spend time with him. We need to walk with him. We need to resist sin. We need to put our flesh to death. And so may the Lord encourage us, especially if we see this love within our hearts this evening and realize the grace that the Lord has shown to us. May he give to us a continued grace to draw near to him and to strengthen that love so that we might find the strength to do all that is in our heart to do towards his kingdom. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer and let's ask the Lord to help us.